Mr. Sakurai, President of Japan Society, thank you very much for your kind introductions. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to wish you a very warm welcome to tonight's events. My name is Yasuyuki Matsumoto. I'm a member of the board of the Norin Chukin Bank. Important part of my responsibility is the oversight and promotion of the bank's international food and agriculture businesses. It is my honor to introduce our bank as well as the other two Japanese partners for tonight's events to you, i.e. the Zenno and ABC Cooking Studio. First, we the Norin Chukin Banks are the national level organization of agriculture, fishery, and forestry cooperative banking businesses in Japan. We are also an internationally active financial institution. Our mission is to support the agriculture, fishery, forestry industries and contribute the development of food production, consumption, and a better quality of life. Second, let me introduce the Zenno. Zenno is a national level organization that conducts business activities for Japanese agriculture sector. They share the same mission as us, and in particular, responsible for the marketing of agriculture products and the procurement of farm inputs for the JA cooperative members and the other independent farmers in Japan. Last but not the least, ABC Cooking Studio. ABC, as you may know, the most popular cooking school in Japan. Through its casual and friendly lessons, the school is introducing healthy, delicious, and sophisticated Japanese cuisine to its students in both Japan and overseas. Norin Chukin Bank, Zenno, and ABC are cooperating to jointly promote Japanese food culture and quality agriculture products to overseas market. Wagyu is one of them. We have worked together to introduce quality Japanese food and products in overseas food festivals and exhibitions, as well as all events for inbound visitors to Japan. For tonight's event, I warmly invite all of you to share the knowledge and the features and the experience of quality Japanese beef, Wagyu. Please enjoy. Now, I have the pleasure of handing over to Mr. Ryuta Kawano, General Manager, Meat and Agriculture Products of the Zenno. Thank you very much.
Mr. Matsumoto, thank you for your kind introduction. So my name is Ryuta Kawano. I'm from Zenno. So Zenno is now importing and carrying Japanese Wagyu beef and then Japanese food in the US. So today, let me explain the what is Japanese Wagyu. So as you know, this is a Japanese Wagyu A5 strip loin. So this meat has a nice marbling, nice flavor. And then I'm in Wagyu business for 15 years. So every time this Wagyu beef attracts me. And then I don't have Wagyu beef in my life, so I almost became like a Wagyu beef. So this is a Chinese character of Japanese Wagyu. So Wa means Japanese or Japan. And then the Gyu, maybe some of you guys is very hard to pronounce. So Gyu means the cattle. This is the original meaning. And then, so what is the definition of authentic Japanese Wagyu? So the first of all, that is pure Japanese Wagyu breeds. And then that is born and raised in Japan. And then there is four species in Japanese Wagyu categories. And 95% of Wagyu beef is Japanese black. This has a high marbling and a high, high genetic quality. And this is a Japanese Wagyu, the picture. They are now feeding the rice straw. It's a very important thing. And then, as you know, the Wagyu beef has a distinctive flavor and tasty. We call this flavor as peaches and coconuts. You know. And then the Wagyu beef's fat is very nice. And you heard the melt in your mouth because that melting point is 80 degrees. That is lower than your body temperature. And melting your mouth and easy to digest. It's very scientific. And then, as well as the Wagyu beef, so A5 is well-known words. So ABC, that means yield grade. And A is highest. And then 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 means meat quality grade. The 5 is the highest grade. American people like A5. So I recommend A5 or A4, many kinds of parts. Yes. Yes, so when we grade the Wagyu beef, we cut the middle of shoulder, and then we grade in the point of the high marbling, the fat inside the beef, and the color, and the brightness, and its fat quality in the many points of view. So this is a nice beef, so if I cut my shoulder like this, maybe. Nobody knows the grading my grading. My boss knows about that. So I will talk the how to raise Wagyu beef in Japan. So Japanese beef has a own name, like Hanako or Takashi, like your social security number. And then we are feeding the mainly corn and wheat and Japanese rice straw. Actually, the corn and wheat is mainly from US. Yes. And then this is a big point, and rice straw in Japan is, rice is very good. We think that rice straw makes a very, very nice fat. This is a big, important thing, I tell you. And then Japanese Wagyu is taken care of individually by the farmers. And then the we have USDA certified exporting meat packing plant in Japan, the 11 packing plant in Japan. It's very strictly hygienic control to support the high quality beef to US. And they are now cutting the boning and then under the very controlled plant. Yes, so and then now, so Japanese Wagyu is getting popular and popular in US and Asia and Europe. So in the future, we can enjoy Japanese Wagyu in Japan. So I'm very concerned about it. My energy. And then we Zenno is now promoting the Japanese Wagyu to US more and more with your right knowledge and with your huge consumption. Please enjoy Wagyu beef. Thank you very much. So I'm concluding my talk here, and I will now invite Professor Botsman, please, up to the stage, please.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here, and thank you for the very warm welcome. I realize that you're all starting to feel hungry. And that I am now the main thing standing between you and all the delicious samples of real Japanese Wagyu that await you this evening. But in the spirit of providing a little bit of an intellectual appetizer to the food that awaits you, let me offer a few observations about the history of beef in Japan. Now, as Mr. Kano has just reminded us, Wagyu today is a global phenomenon. So I'm originally from Australia, and I was recently at home visiting my mother, and I was in Melbourne, and I came across a restaurant called Wagyu Ya, which literally means Wagyu restaurant or Wagyu place. And of course, I had to go in. It was very expensive. It was very delicious. But the thing that struck me most about it was that just a couple of weeks prior to being in Melbourne and going to this place, I'd come across in Greenfield, Massachusetts, a similar restaurant called Kobe. And I think this is indicative of the extent to which Japan is now associated around the world with wonderfully delicious meat. But if we were all to jump in a time machine tonight and go back 150 years or so, I suspect we would have a very hard time finding anybody who would have predicted such an outcome, whether they were in Japan or outside. And the reason for that is that for centuries prior to the Meiji Restoration in 1868, cattle enjoyed a special status in Japan and were considered worthy of protection and care. So in other words, what I'm suggesting to you is that something like what we now think of as the sacred cow in India, something similar to that idea, has also formed a very important strand in the culture of the Japanese archipelago. How deep could that history have been? Well, the imperial court began issuing the first official decrees banning the slaughter of cattle and admonishing people to treat them kindly from at least as early as the 8th century under the Emperor Shomu. Now, there's no need for us to think that everybody immediately obeyed those decrees from on high, but it's very clear that in the centuries that followed those early decrees, that an aversion to the killing of domestic animals, and in particular cattle, became widespread throughout the Japanese islands. And this was something that the first Europeans to get to Japan in the 16th century routinely noticed and noted. So for example, many of you may have heard of Francis Xavier, the very first Jesuit and the first European to reach Japan. He wrote in 1549 that, quote, "The Japanese neither kill nor eat animals that they have raised themselves." Now, the Europeans, of course, had very different ideas about what was appropriate to eat. And I think it's worth noting that at the end of the 16th century, when the great warlord Toyotomi Hideyoshi issued the first expulsion order against the Jesuits, one of the justifications he gave for throwing them out of the country was their custom of slaughtering cattle. Under the Tokugawa, who, of course, inherited the foundations of a new kind of state that had been laid by Hideyoshi and who built an enduring peace, bans on the slaughter of cattle start being issued from around 1612. But it was really under the, oh, and I forgot to show you, I stole this from Kano-san's presentation, but you're an A5 to me. I'm sure I'm much lower down. Yes, anyway, sorry, I apologize. I meant to kind of provide a kind of visual appetizer as I was speaking. But to get back to my history story here, so the fifth Tokugawa shogun, who was a man named Tsunayoshi, who reigned from 1680 to 1709, it was under his reign, during his reign, that this kind of culture of cattle protection really reaches its highest point. So Tsunayoshi, as I'm sure many of you know, is sometimes remembered today as the dog shogun, Inukubo. But I actually think he might just as well be remembered today as the cow shogun, because in fact, the laws that he put in place for the protection of cattle were, if anything, even further reaching than the more famous laws that he enacted to protect dogs. So there's at least one documented case of a man being crucified for killing a cow during Tsunayoshi's reign. And it's also under Tsunayoshi that the abandonment of sick cattle was made a punishable offense. So if you were the owner of a cow, the requirement from Tsunayoshi's reign on to the end of the Tokugawa period was that you should nurture that animal and continue to care for it until its last dying breath. And in order to help ensure that that was actually carried out, Tsunayoshi put in place a special registration system for cattle around the country so that their whereabouts and well-being could be checked on. So why would a powerful man like Tsunayoshi, or Hideyoshi before him, have cared so much about cows? Well, that's a complex question. Part of the answer undoubtedly has to do with Japan's religious traditions, and particularly the teachings of Buddhism about the importance of compassion for living creatures. But I'd suggest to you that there was also a much more practical reason for this. Cattle, it turns out, were also extremely important for something else we associate very closely with Japan, namely the cultivation of rice. So one of the early farmers' manuals that started to circulate in Japan from the late 16th and 17th centuries was something called the Seigyoki. And it stated outright that if you do not have a cow, you cannot farm rice. So cattle, as you can imagine, were used to pull plows. They were used to haul loads. And just as importantly, they produced manure, which was especially valuable and prized for its role in fertilizing fields. And for all of those reasons, farmers were thought to rely very heavily on cattle. So for a ruler to protect cattle also was a way to promote and encourage and protect agriculture more generally. And agriculture, of course, was understood to be the foundation of the state. And it's worth remembering in that regard that throughout the Tokugawa period, taxes were collected in rice, not money. So the more rice that was grown, the more taxes were being collected. So I think that's part of the story. But at the same time, it's also important to note, I think, that from the time of Emperor Shomu's earliest decrees, cattle were portrayed as animals that helped humans by laboring on their behalf. And for that reason, they were also widely understood to be worthy and deserving of human gratitude and kindness. Now, I want to be very clear About the fact that I'm not suggesting that Japan before the Meiji Restoration was a purely vegetarian society. It certainly was not. In addition to fish, various kinds of meat were consumed. In general, though, there does seem to have been a distinction maintained between game animals, like wild boar, inoshishi, sometimes also called yamakujira, the whales of the mountains, which were okay to eat, and domesticated animals, such as cattle, which were generally not. Now, even in the case of domestic animals, it's true that exceptions were sometimes made. And particularly important in that regard was the notion of kusurigui, or medicinal eating. And this was the idea that it was sometimes beneficial and necessary to eat unusual foods, things you would not usually eat, because they were known to strengthen the body and fortify it against illness. And we know from Chinese medical texts that circulated widely in the Tokugawa period that beef was in fact one of the foods that was recognized as having just those properties and being important for medicinal purposes. So probably the most famous example of medicinal eating of beef in the Tokugawa period is provided by the Yi family, the fearsome warrior lords of Hikone domain in Omi, whose retainers had formed the vanguard of the Tokugawa forces during the great battle of Sekigahara. So at the beginning of winter every year, the Yi lords, and you may have heard of Yi Naosuke, probably the most famous lord in this family, and a very important figure in the kind of final decades of the Tokugawa period. But the Yi lords are known to have presented a gift of specially prepared beef products, beef marinated in miso, dried beef, and so on, to the shogun in Edo every year to help them fortify their bodies during the coldest months of the winter. And to this day, cattle from Omi, the Hikone area, are among the most prized and famous Wagyu beef cattle in Japan. Now, it's important to emphasize, though, that the case, the example of the Yi lords giving beef to the shogun was really a quite exceptional one. This was a special thing. These were extremely high-ranking and privileged people. And even then, beef was consumed only at particular times of the year and as a kind of medicine to help fortify the body. So in general, I think it's fair to say that beef really did form a very marginal part of Japanese food culture. So when does that start to change? Well, I don't think I'm giving too much away when I say that the big turning point comes with the arrival of the Western powers on Japan's doorstep in the mid-19th century. This is an image that I really love. I think this is a Japanese black. Do you think, Kawano-san, that looks like it? And what's portrayed here is an American butcher or an American killing a cow. And this was a portrait of the kind of strange, or part of a series of images that depicted the strange customs of Westerners in Yokohama. And the text here is by a very famous author from this period named Kanagaki Robun, who seems to have been quite fascinated by this whole strange custom of beef eating. So you may also, some of you may have heard of his very famous piece called agranabe, or that's a very awkward English translation, but cross-legged around the beef pot. So this was a story which basically satirized the craze for beef eating, which spread in the very early years of the Meiji period amongst avant-garde dandies who were basically keen to imitate all things Western in the name of civilization and enlightenment, bunmei kaika. Robun was basically making fun of this kind of imitating of Western habits in this story. But this is indicative, nonetheless, of the fact that amongst certain groups of people in Japan, beef eating does start to catch on fairly soon after the restoration. So how does that mesh then with what I said earlier about this culture of cattle protection in Tokugawa Japan, and this idea that, you know, Japan had a culture of the sacred cow, not so dissimilar to India. Why was there not, if that was true, why would there not have been more resistance to beef eating in the Meiji period? Well, I think it's important to acknowledge that there was, in fact, some resistance. There was, soon after it was announced that the Meiji Emperor had started to eat beef, for example, a group of religious practitioners launched an attack on the imperial palace to protest this. So there were examples of real resistance. At the same time, though, I think we can also identify a number of factors that helped to smooth the way for the gradual acceptance of beef in Japan. The first thing to point out, I think, is that over the course of the Tokugawa period, there seems to be a gradual decline in the importance of draft animals for agriculture. So instead of just relying on manure, various kinds of commercial fertilizer became available and widely used. Instead of having cattle pull plows, new kinds of plows were invented which human beings could pull for themselves just as efficiently and effectively. And so I think all of that meant that by the end of the Tokugawa period, cattle were actually less important for agriculture than they had been a century or two earlier. The second thing to note was, of course, the deep concern about military preparedness that gripped Japan's samurai leadership in the mid-19th century. Commodore Perry had, after all, arrived with a flotilla of gunboats. And the Americans were quick to point out that the British Empire was expanding very quickly on Japan's doorstep. And all of that helped to stimulate new interest in military technology and organization, of course, but it also made people start thinking about how to bolster the physical strength of individual soldiers. And in that context, the old idea of kusurigui, of medicinal eating, started to mesh with new Western ideas about the importance of beef for creating strong, virile male bodies. And as a result, government authorities start experimenting with the promotion of beef eating specifically for soldiers. And one of the earliest cases I've found of this is Wakayama domain, which already in the 1860s is trying to get Wagyu cows to feed to its samurai. Now, a third factor that I think helps to explain the acceptance of beef eating in Japan in this period were the profits that could suddenly be generated by selling cattle to beef-hungry Westerners. Now, of course, the number of Westerners who actually took up residence in Japan in the Meiji period was very small. But it's important to realize that beef in various forms was also one of the most important foods for the crews of the Western ships that began calling on Japanese ports with increasing frequency in this period. So if we look at one of the earliest editions of the Hyogo and Osaka Herald, which was an English language newspaper set up in the treaty port of Kobe soon after its opening to Western residents, what do we find? Well, first we see a call for bids from the British Navy for merchants who were able to supply naval ships with fresh, prime, well-fed ox beef. And second, as you look through the pages of this English language newspaper in this period, you find lots and lots of ads from Western butchers. So there were French butchers, there were German butchers, there were American butchers, there were British butchers, there were German butchers. And they all set up shop in Kobe within a week of it opening as a treaty port. Now, I mentioned the profits that stood to be made from the trade, but given the importance of shipping for Western commercial activity, we shouldn't be surprised to learn that the Western powers also put a lot of political pressure on the early Meiji government to ensure that there were adequate supplies of beef in the treaty ports. So I think this too helps to explain how beef eating and a beef industry began to take root in 19th century Japan. Against that background, Kobe turns out to have played an especially important role. I'm sure you've all heard of Kobe beef, probably the most famous brand of Japanese Wagyu beef, along perhaps with Matsuzaka beef. My own interest in this topic started actually when I realized how quickly Kobe had come to be associated with beef production. So why was this the case? How did Kobe become a center for beef? Well, the key factor, it turns out, had to do, or the key reason was really the regional distribution of cattle in Japan at the moment that it opened to the West. So in 1872, I'm almost finished, don't worry, just a few years after the restoration, Japan's new government conducted a survey of national resources, including cattle and horses. And this map basically shows what that survey revealed. So basically, the green parts on this map are areas where there were very, very, very few cattle. Red meant there were a lot of cattle, and the darker yellow meant more cattle. And what this reveals is that you can basically draw a line across the middle of the main island of Japan at Lake Biwa. And on one side, we have a cattle zone. On the other side, a horse zone. So the main draft animals on the northeastern side of this line were horses, whereas on the southwestern side, cattle were far more important. Now, the other thing that these figures show is that the mountainous areas of the Chugoku region, so today's Okayama Prefecture and Hiroshima Prefecture, as well as Hyogo Prefecture, the mountainous parts of those areas of Japan, had a particularly strong association with the raising of cattle. Why mountains? You know, in the US or in Australia, we tend to associate cattle with wide open spaces, huge ranches, but not in Japan. And the reason, again, has to do with rice. If you had plains in Japan, you wanted to grow rice on the plains, and you did not want herds of cattle stomping around on those plains where you had just planted rice. So the raising of cattle tends to have happened in the mountains. And in the mountains, too, rather than having large numbers of cattle controlled by a single family, families would basically raise small numbers of animals. And they would then sell them to cow herders, or ushibakuro, who would bring them to markets across Japan's cattle belt, including this one, the Tennoji cattle market in Osaka, which was really at its height in the 17th century, but before it was supplanted by other cattle markets. But in any case, Kobe happened to stand on one of the most important Tokugawa period cattle trading routes. And so it was ideally situated to become an early supplier of beef for Western ships. Now these days, of course, lots of things have changed. Wagyu cattle are being raised in many different parts of Japan, and you can get delicious Wagyu beef from many areas of the country, including many which were not in this cattle zone. You may have heard of Yonezawa beef, which is, again, one of the most famous Wagyu brands, and it is from an area that was outside the Tokugawa period cattle zone. But as Mr. Kawano has pointed out, small-scale family farm-based production, in which the animals are treated with special care, remains the norm for true Japanese Wagyu. And this, I think, is something that very much grows out of the kind of practices and the broader history that I've quickly gone over this evening. So the idea of raising cattle on small-scale farms and treating them as treasures, I think, has a lot to do with this longer background of cattle protection. You've all been very patient with me, and I'm not going to go on much longer, but let me just emphasize one last thing. And that is that although beef eating started to gain a foothold in the Meiji period, the legacies of the Tokugawa period meant that it remained a fairly minor part of Japanese culinary culture well into the 20th century. And that, I think, has also meant that Japanese farmers who have wanted to promote the consumption of beef have had to work extra hard to make their products more palatable and appealing to consumers. In other words, to overcome the legacies of the Tokugawa period, they have had to make the most delicious product in the world. And of course, a key part of that has been the development of techniques that would lead to the rich marbling and delicious flavor that we now associate generally with Wagyu. So in all of these ways then, in spite of the relatively short history of beef eating in Japan, I think it's true that when we enjoy real Wagyu today, we are all very much the beneficiaries of the accumulated wisdom of Japan's rich agrarian traditions. Thank you all very much. It's my pleasure now to introduce Miss Jennifer Suzuki, who is actually going to show you how to prepare this wonderful food.
My name is Jennifer. I'm coming from ABC Cooking Studio from Japan directly. We arrive on a Monday and prepare for this event. And together with my colleague, Rina, so we're going to introduce two wonderful dishes using a Wagyu beef. Have you cooked Wagyu beef before at home? No, this is great. So if you say yes, then I don't have to be here, right? So then today, two dishes, as I said. We're going to make one with the sushi. Beef with the sushi. It's interesting, right? Right, I know. And it's very difficult to make sushi, everyone think, but it's very easy. I will show you how easy it is to cook the sushi. And the other one is sukiyaki. Have you eaten sukiyaki, everyone? Yes, I know, it's so good, right? I know, it's very delicious. But it's very easy to cook at home, so I would love you to try it at home, all right? So, let me introduce to do that sukiyaki is later on, so I'm gonna show you how to do with the vinegar, sushi vinegar with the yuzu, using the yuzu juice. Do you know what yuzu is? Right, so it's becoming a very popular in US as well. It's also like, of course, we use in Japan very much in yuzu, and we like this flavor. So first we are going to make a yuzu flavored sushi vinegar. So sushi vinegar is, we have the sushi vinegar here. It's very already, you can buy it in the store. So we have a 2 tablespoons of sushi vinegar and 1 tablespoon of yuzu juice. And we just mix it, and that's done. So this is already yuzu-flavored sushi vinegar. And we have here now already prepared a nicely cooked, there we go, I can't see it, but it's already cooked. But it's a cooked rice, we already prepared in advance. This is, we're gonna put in this special wooden bowl. And when you cook the rice for a sushi, please use a little, slightly less water than usual, because you know we want to put this vinegar later on, so the rice have to have a little space to suck all those vinegar in it. So I would like you to cook a little less, like probably just like usually 1 to 1.2. So you use the 1 to 1.1 or 1. So it's 1 rice and 1 water. So it's a little harder than usual rice. But don't worry, because we're gonna add those we just made yuzu flavored, you see, vinegar over the rice. Okay. So first you think it's a lot of water in it. So you think it's like, whoa, that's a lot of water, but it's really interesting. The rice will suck all the vinegar and the yuzu juice. So each rice will get all the nicely taste yuzu flavored sushi rice. So we don't want the rice to be a matchy. So we don't want to mix like this. You don't do that. We kind of slice the rice like this to cut so that we want the rice grains to be separated from each other so that each rice grains will have nice flavor of yuzu juice and the rice vinegar. So now it's getting a little thicker. And once you feel that the rice is a little heavier, you use this nice uchiwa. Have you seen this before in Japan? Yeah? We use that in the summertime, but we use that all the time in the cooking, so, which is nice. So she would do that half mommy and fan to it. So this would help to get rid of excess of the moisture. You don't want to have that too much moisture in the rice. So we do that to fan it and mix it like this. So we'll have a nicely shiny rice. And the reason we use also this special bowl, this is a very special bowl for making a sushi rice. And this wood would take also the excess of the moisture as well. And have that, of course, a lot of space to make, to mix very easily. So I think it's as well nice. And today, we want to have something special to match with the Wagyu beef. So today, we are going to put green perilla. You know green perilla? It's called shiso. It's a green shiso. Oh, yes. I saw it in this market today, in the supermarket. It's like I was surprised, actually. It's very popular here in U.S. as well. And also, we're going to add sesame. We love sesame. Do you guys also love sesame? Oh, I'm so glad that everyone loves all those ingredients. So we're going to make that. It's also beautiful. Usually, sushi is a white, plain sushi rice, right? It's boring. So why don't we make this something happy? So we're going to have a green, nice, with the sesame. It's too bad that you can't smell it, right? Like, I wish I can go like this. It's really nice with the yuzu flavor, and also the shiso has a nice, intense aroma to it. So we have a very nice aroma sushi rice. So we want to have a sushi to be cool it down. So we're going to leave that and have dumped cloth, covered it. We don't want to have all those rice to be dried out, and leave it later to cool it down. So I'm going to cool it down for a bit. We will come back to later on. Now, while we're waiting for cool it down the rice, we're going to go into roast beef. So roast beef is going to be on the top of sushi, which is really, for me, it's exciting, but I mean, it's very different. It's usually it's a fish on the top of sushi, but we're going to use that as since we're in a promoting a Wagyu, right? So then we have to put the Wagyu on the top of the sushi. So we are having, I have to show you a beautiful A5, of course. A beautiful, right? Which one is beautiful? Kano-san or this? Hey, come on. Here we go. Of course, it is a beautiful one, but I mean, this is also beautiful. Hey. Okay, so we're going to have seasoned with the salt and pepper. Where did I have the salt and pepper? I forgot about that. Maybe. Oh, yeah, here we go. So we're going to have the salt and pepper to it, right? And this is very usual Japanese salt, like comes like this. And it's a very different. It's in Japanese salt is always small like this, right? So we're going to have in salt and pepper. Okay. And a pepper as well. It is the same. Like, I think it's in a, usually people think it's like roast beef, it takes a long time to cook. But the Wagyu has a very nice fat, as Kano-san already explained, has a very soft fat, and it has a very nice taste to it. So it takes a very easy to cook and in a very shortened time to prepare the roast beef. And here you see, this is the beef taro. Usually, you kind of waste your fat, right? You just get rid of the fat from the beef, but don't do that. As he said, scientifically, right? It's good for your body, he said. Right? It's easy to digest. So we use this fat for cooking the beef because the fat already has a nice aroma to it, so you don't want it to waste it. And so we're gonna use this fat, and it has a nice fat comes up. So we're gonna kick that. And, ooh, it's a very thick, nice meat. So, go like this. So, we're gonna fry it with a high heat for 2 minutes each side. Okay, and 2 minutes, it's actually quite a long time, so I have to talk something fun, but I know. I was kind of prepare something, but I'm so nervous now, like I can't even think about it. So here we go. So we're gonna have the 2 minutes. Usually go to 2 minutes each side, and we wanna have that it's nicely brown like this. Okay. Ooh, it's nice, right? Do you smell that? Oh, I know. Don't worry. It's in 10 minutes. You would have the nice beef over there. Okay, so we're gonna have this 2 minutes each side, and don't forget that. We wanna have that on the side too. You don't want to have that, you know, you don't wanna have the, oh, you get that all nice smells here. All right, then you don't wanna have the, all the nice juice comes outside. You're gonna make the pour, close it with the oil. And if you don't have the beef taro at home, don't worry. Don't do that with the butters or anything else. Use the vegetable oil. The vegetable oil doesn't have a lot of taste to it, so it doesn't disturb a nice Wagyu beef taste. As he said, it's a coconut and peach taste, and you know, you don't want to disturb that with the butters and anything. So you want to have that nicely, nice aroma, the beef aroma, as to keep, use the vegetable oil. But of course, when you buy the beef, you get all those fats, so you can use that as it. So once it's nicely browned, we're gonna move it to that. I'm gonna cook it. Now I'm gonna cook a roast beef. All right, roast beef, I don't put it in an oven. I put in aluminum foil, okay? This is, we're gonna cover it in aluminum foil, like this. And let the Wagyu beef work themselves alone for 20 minutes. Okay, so it's gonna be, because it's really hot, so it goes to all the heat remaining inside. And as he said, yeah, here we go. As he said, it's the fat, it's the temperature to melt it is very low. So it goes very easily, nicely, well done. A roast beef, but you don't want to have a dry, the Wagyu beef is very soft, so we don't want to have that, it's a dry one, so we want to have like nice, medium, rare type of the Wagyu to be cooked, so it's nicely have a little freshness of a sushi taste. So we don't want to wash that, because we have a very nice aroma to it, right? So we don't want to waste it. We're going to use this to make nice sauce. So we have a 1 teaspoon of soy sauce, and this is a 1 tablespoon of sake, and 2 tablespoons of mirin. And we're gonna have, all right. So this is like, everyone knows like teriyaki sauce, right? So Wagyu beef has already nice sweet and aroma, so you don't want to put just the soy sauce. It's ruined this nice sweet and taste. So we want to have a nice sweet aroma, sweet sauce to eat with it. So it goes with a nice taste, umami from the Wagyu beef in the oil, and with the sauce, it's a caramelized. And it's very nicely, you see that? So this comes with the later on the top of the sushi, and we're gonna have that, instead of a soy sauce, we're gonna have that sauce. All right, so while we're waiting for the roast beef and sushi to be cooled down, we're gonna move it for a second dish. Second dish, as I said, sukiyaki, I know, right? How excited? Am I the only one excited? Come on, everyone excited, right? Oh yeah, I know, thank you. So, here we go. We're gonna have this beautiful vegetable. Oh no, forget, today is a beef. Here's a beautiful, hello! she's the main one today. Hello, beautiful Wagyu, hello. So, how beautiful is she? Too bad that she doesn't talk, right? So, okay. So we're gonna cook this beautiful Wagyu and sukiyaki. I mean, this is beautiful, but of course we wanna have everything to be beautiful. So We are going to use also a Japanese fresh vegetable. We're going to use this green onion. And we separated the white part and green part. Usually people don't eat this green part. Don't throw it away. They're all tasty. So we're going to cook the very thin, tiny slice of the green part. And tomato. Well, you don't see that often, tomato in the sukiyaki. But try. It's very tasty. Believe me. If you didn't like it, just call me. And usually we do a lot of time in Mizuna in Japan, but we can also use this Chinese cabbage. We call it haksai. And of course, tofu. Tofu, don't miss the tofu. And the shiitake mushrooms. All right, these are all cleaned and prepared, but I just only want to show you how to prepare the shiitake mushroom like this. It's beautiful, right? Mm, you do that? Oh, you have to. All right, I'll show you how to do it. It is very easy. It's not, you don't have to be artist to do that. Okay, I even can do it, so I'll show it to you. Okay, you just mark a slightly like this, and in the middle, and three times. Okay, so line to it, I'll show you. Go diagonally. Like this, and you don't want to waste that, so we're gonna put later on to eat it, and the both side. Okay. All right. So am I nervous, or like everyone is so quiet it's to concentrate on the cooking? Okay, good. Okay. So, oh, this mushroom has a hole in it. Well, it's interesting, but. Anyway, so the reason we do this decoration, of course, it looks nice, right? But of course, that makes also easy to soak the old flavor and easy to cook as well. So it's not only for the decoration. It is also for the reason we do that. And here we go. What do you think? It's a hole in it, but here we go. Thank you. All right, so it's very easy, so I would like you to try at home as well and then to impress your friends and your family, right? So this is also prepared. The beef is ready there and the vegetables there. We only need one more thing, just a sauce for sukiyaki sauce. You can also buy this finished product, but it's better to make it by own because some people like sweeter or some people like more saltier, you know, like you can manage all the things. So today I would like to show you just only one tablespoon of sugar. Going like this, one tablespoon of sugar. And two tablespoons of sake. Okay, and two tablespoons of soy sauce. So if you like sweeter more, you can also add more sugar to it or mirin to it. And of course, if you like more salty way, salty taste, then you can put more soy sauce and mix well. So it's done. This preparation is all done. It's very easy, right? So, good. Now it's the sukiyaki. You can smell very nice. Okay, now I am going to show you how to prepare the sukiyaki at home. All right, so before, same as before, we have, here's beef taro. We have it in a high heat. Okay, and have all the fat is dissolved. And we love to use those fat beef taro all the time because, as I said, it already has a nice aroma and the umami to it. So once the fat is dissolved, we're gonna take it out. And the first, I would like to put the white part of green onion. The green onion is the most of the time is the hardest vegetable, so you wanna cook it first. You don't want to cook the meat first because the meat gets too hard when you have that, you know, too long to cook. So we're going to cook it like this and it's slightly becoming a brown. You smell that? It's a nice onion smell. So you want to have this nice aroma to attach to that beef. So we're going to go move on to, ooh, nice. Oh, too bad you can't touch it. It's even soft. I know, right? It has been a great massage, and well, she has been. I'm sure, like they had a nice beer and fit it, and I don't know what they have already fed it in this nice, beautiful Wagyu, but it's really, really soft. Okay, it's a beautiful color. Okay, so we want to have the cover over the onion so that the meat gets nice aroma of the. Of the onion, and we wanted to cover this nice juice inside of the beef, so we sprinkle the 1 tablespoon of sugar over the meat. It's a new, right? I know, Japanese love sugar. So here we go. But wonder why everyone is so skinny, right? I know. Maybe we eat too much Wagyu. So here we go. So once it's like this, the reason we put a sugar, so the heat caramelizes the sugar, to cover the all the meat, so meat doesn't reduce the water outside, stays inside. So once later on, even you cook, the beef will stay a very nice soft texture, right? And if you don't believe, try it. So okay, and then we wanted to add a little bit of taste to it, so. The sukiyaki sauce we just made, just only 1 tablespoon of it, and then over it. Ooh. Okay. So we're gonna have like a little bit, it's already cooked with, right? And we want to cook that. And we wanna have the vegetables and everything at the same time to be cooked, so we're gonna really move on to leave that. Somehow the mushrooms are so big in the U.S. It's like, we thought it was like mushrooms Japanese, but it's like I was surprised that the mushrooms here is so big then compared to Japan. So maybe you guys have a different special water in here or something. So it's really interesting. All right, so we're going to put just a tofu and shiitake mushroom. All right. Beautiful, even it's a beautiful way. Okay, and then add the rest of the sukiyaki sauce, everything over it. Ooh, nice. Okay, so we're gonna leave lid on. Don't worry, I'm come back to those nice vegetables later on. We're gonna cut lid on and reduce it for simmer for about 5 minutes. And while we're waiting for 5 minutes, I mean, I'm here not to talking today. I'm here for demonstration, so we're going back to sushi. All right, so sushi is here now. It's cooled down, yeah? Sushi rice. We have today a special way of sushi. It's called oshizushi. Have you heard of it before, oshizushi? No? Oh, this is good. Everything is new today. Good. All right. So oshizushi, we use this very special form. Okay. This is from like Osaka region. It's very famous, a very popular sushi from Osaka region, which is Kansai region. Osaka is a Kansai region. And we're going to put it here. And this is... the reason we do it, because we don't want to have to use your hands to make the sushi. It's very difficult. So we're just going to cheat on, right? Okay. And it looks professionally after all. So, okay. And this oshizushi means, it directly translated is pressed sushi. So you can imagine what I'm going to do, right? With this rice. So... okay, nicely fit it. Okay. It's all done. Then we have a lid. Press sushi means press it. All right. And another, we're gonna let them press it for a while. So if you don't have this at home, you can use a loaf pan instead. You know, you can put the plastic saran wrap and then put the rice and press something on the top. and so you can have the same effect. Okay, so we're gonna do that, and we are going to, maybe it's 20 minutes is over, maybe not, but I wanna check on my roast beef. What's going on roast beef? So, hello, beef. Oh, say hello, everyone. Hi, right? So I wanna see what's going on in the beef. Do you believe it's already cooked? Yeah? Okay. Here we go. Let me see. Oh, look at this. You wanna see it? How beautiful is that? Beautiful, right? All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. So we wanna have very thin slice to it because of Wagyu beef. Has a very nice texture, so you wanna have this like nice sliced. There we go. Okay, it's like this. So you're gonna slice that very thin because it's, you know, sushi, you don't wanna have the very chunk of the fish on the top of sushi, it's the same thing. You wanna have a nicely thin sliced beef. So, it's magic, it's already pressed. We have already prepared before, of course. So what we have is, I know I cheated. So what we have is, it's really nice, this thing. We have this, you see what it is? I know, this is a Japanese technology, I think. Here, I know, here we go. You have even put in a knife into it. How specific the Japanese should be, right? Have to be like this. Okay, so you just put a knife into this thing. Goes on like this. So it's already a very nicely equal amount. All right, so would you like to see what's going on? Right, let me see. You're gonna press it. You're gonna press it. Oh, yeah, I know. Here we go. Ta-da! Nicely already formed sushi is already there. You don't have it even like you do with your hand, right? So we're gonna have that sushi there and put the roast beef on the top. And I already cheated again. I know, I'm sorry. I know. I've already cheated, but you know, I love cooking, so I've been cooking all day today. So here we go. I wanna have like nicely, nice Wagyu beef sushi, and we're gonna decorate that. We made a nice sauce before, so we're gonna add like this, right? It's this teriyaki sauce, which is so nice, tasty. And we're gonna have decorated with wasabi. Do you like wasabi? Yeah, I know, right? American loves some wasabi, so I'm gonna put like tons of it so everyone can cry it on. Right, okay, and put the yuzu slice on it. So it's beautiful like this. And I am so happy today as she's helping me so she can finish up the decoration. All right, so because of that, while she is finishing up the decoration, I have to take care of my business here. Here we go. Ta-da! So it's been cooked for 5 minutes, and then just before finishing up, we're gonna put the rest of the vegetable. These are very thin sliced vegetables like this, so it's very easy to cook. So we only need a couple minutes to be cooked. So we're gonna leave on the top. We wanna have a nice color to it, so you don't wanna mix it everything, because if you mix it, the vegetable is gonna be really brown. So we wanna keep it like that, and leave it like this, and leave it for 5 minutes. So here's the thing. We are usually eat sukiyaki with the raw beaten egg, right? In Japan. But I believe in US don't eat the raw egg, right? No, right, exactly. So we don't do that. Only the reason we do is, it's, well, of course we love eggs, but and instead of that, we have, because of the sukiyaki sauce has a very rich taste, right? So you can't eat all the time with the whole thing with this rich taste. So because the raw egg helps you to reduce the rich taste to it, so you can eat continue a lot, right? Yeah, I know, this is one of the reasons to have the raw egg too. So, and if you don't want to have a raw egg, of course you can have with onsen tamago, which is, it's kind of the soft boiled egg. 2 minutes boiled egg, you can use that. But today, we have prepared this with a lighter taste to it, so you don't have to eat with any of the eggs. And in Japan also, people eat gathering together sukiyaki from the pot directly to eat and to serve on bowl, right? But I know like some people in US doesn't like to share all the whole pot. You know, it's mine is mine, you know, like I wanna have my own. I know. You know, me is the same. I wanna have my own. So if you like that, of course you can serve in the bowl, you know. So you can have that. So you will ready? I wanna hire a very nice wall, yeah? Okay? Here we go. Voila. Ah, thank you. I know. So the thing is, these are very, it's already cooked, but we want to have this color in that way because it's very beautiful, right? And you will see. So we're going to have, okay, I'm going to have this. Put in that in the, ooh, nice. Oh, this is really nice. Okay, so. Oh, this Wagyu beef is doing a very good job here. Okay. So, gonna have this nicely served in the bowl. And everyone loves tofu as well. All right. Okay. I'm just gonna add the nicely. Okay, oops, Ada. Oh, it's very hot. Okay, I would have nice cabbage. And if you like more taste to it, you can put any vegetables actually. The taste of the sukiyaki sauce comes with, any of the vegetables like you like. If you like to have like a, for example, I put a lettuce sometimes instead of the cabbage or any green onions or usual, like normal onions as well, like you can put that. And these are very tasty as well. And in Japan, we also enjoy how the, with the food with the eye as well. So, you know, that's the reason we also made shiitake with this nice decoration as well. So I want you to try if you have a time, you can try with this nice decorative shiitake to it. Okay. All right. So maybe it looks better that way. Okay. Okay, so. Here we go. All right. I hope you have enjoyed. All right. Here we go. Maybe it's... Is it nice? Oh, thank you. Did we do a good job? Did we? It's really tasty. I mean, the Wagyu beef did a very good job, so we didn't just cook it. But these are very tasty, and it's very easy to prepare. So please enjoy. And at the end of the day, end of this event, you can take home the recipe from us. So and please enjoy and have fun the rest of the event. Thank you very much.